And welcome to our Kid City Kids online experience. We are so happy that you chose to be with us here on this beautiful Sunday. We have an amazing series that we're starting today. But before we get to that, lift your hands up, get some room, and get ready to worship God with all you got. You ready? Let's do it.
Wings of eagles, far beyond the stars. If I sink to the depths of oceans, even there you are. Before me, behind me, above me, below me. You surround me, you sustain me. Promise that you'll always keep me. Before me, behind me, above me, below me. You surround me, you sustain me. Promise that you'll always keep me.
Thank you.
great praise and worship. You guys are amazing. Now, this lesson that we're starting this week, can you guess what it's called? Let me hear it. What is it called? Oh, a little louder. I can't. There you go. Yes. This is our lesson. It's amazing. It's great. It's legendary. So let's get the Pastor Ethan, and he's going to talk to us about what this is all about. I'm so excited. Go ahead, Pastor Ethan.
Hey, guys. Welcome to our new series here in Kid City. We're talking about What a Day. That's right. This new series is going to focus on the last 24 hours of Jesus' life. Because if you all didn't know, there's 24 hours in a day, right? 24 hours. And it's going to be really awesome, you guys, because I don't know if you've realized this yourself. You can fit a lot of stuff into 24 hours. Now, sometimes 24 hours doesn't seem like a long time, like when you forget to do your homework and you know it's due the next day or something like that. But you can actually fit quite a lot of things into it. In fact, I'm pretty sure a single day can change your entire life. For example, you got two people, they're a couple, they're married, and okay, we got two people, but then something happens, and then one day later, now they're three people. That's right, they have a baby, and now it's a whole family. It's not just two people. One 24-hour day changed everything. Now, that's a good example. Unfortunately, there's not always good things that happen to change everything. For example, you can have a nice, lovely, beautiful home to live in, and a roof over your head, and things like that, and then a tornado happens, or a really bad flood storm happens, and then the house is gone, and you can't live in it anymore. That's a bad thing that could happen, but again, it can happen in a single day and change everything. So, we all know now that one day can change everything, but let's talk about one of the biggest days in history, 24 hours, that happened right before Jesus went to the cross. So today we're going to focus on one of the first things that happened called the Last Supper. Now, I don't know if you guys have heard about this before, but we're going to take a look real quick.
The story of Easter, the Last Supper. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like calming storms and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
At this time, the Jewish people were celebrating a festival called Passover that had been celebrated since the time of Moses, when God brought his people out of Egypt. So Jesus was going to Jerusalem to celebrate. The disciples asked Jesus where he wanted to eat the Passover meal that night. Jesus said, "As you go into the city, a man carrying a pitcher of water will meet you.
Hello.
Follow him. At the house he enters, say to the owner,
Hi.
The teacher asks, "Where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?" He will take you upstairs to a large room that is already set up. That is where you should prepare our meal. The disciples found everything to be just as Jesus had said. Later that evening, Jesus arrived with the 12 disciples. They sat down to eat, and Jesus said that he was happy to be with everyone. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. He said, "Take it, for this is my body, which is given for you." Jesus told them to do this to help remember him. Then he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. And he said to his disciples, "This is my blood. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many." Jesus said, "One of you eating with me here will betray me." He told them that things were supposed to happen this way, but that great sadness would await the one who betrays him. The disciples were very upset and asked, "Am I the one? Who is he talking about?" Judas asked Jesus, "Am I the one?" And Jesus said, "You have said it." One of the disciples asked Jesus, "Lord, who is it?" Jesus said it was the one who he would give the bread to. He gave the bread to Judas, and Jesus said, "Hurry and do what you're going to do." None of the others at the table knew what Jesus meant, so Judas left at once to betray Jesus. Then Jesus comforted and encouraged the disciples. He promised them that they would have a helper come when Jesus was gone. They all sang a song to God together.
All right, guys, so today we're talking about the Last Supper, and you guys have probably heard the story before, and even if you haven't, you've probably seen this played out in a church before. You guys know how sometimes over in the grown-up service, they'll do this thing where they'll get some juice and some bread, and they'll pass them out to everybody to eat, and then sometimes, a lot of times they don't do it like this anymore. What they do is they pass out those little cup things with like the lids that are just impossible to get off and the little circle bread things. Well, we call that communion. And what we're doing when we do communion is we are celebrating the Last Supper. Now, Jesus was with his disciples and he knew he was about to leave them to go to the cross. So he was trying to tell them everything he wanted them to know. And one of the most important things he said was, "I want you to remember me. And I'm going to give you something to help you remember me and what I'm doing." So he created communion. Now, this was already a part of Jewish history and Jewish time. They were celebrating Passover and they did the juice and the bread thing, but he gave it a whole new meaning. So today we're going to learn about that, and we're going to take a look at 1 Corinthians 11, which gives us a little bit more information on this whole, how do we do communion stuff together. Now, today's big idea is going to be, I will remember what Jesus did for me. So do it with me. I will remember what Jesus did for me. Boom, 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 boom. Right? Okay. And that's what this is all about. It's all about remembering what Jesus did for us. So let's go learn about the bread and the juice and see how we can learn even more about Jesus' last day on earth. Because what a day!
Have you ever wondered why every once in a while at church people eat a small piece of bread and drink a tiny bit of juice? Is it just snack time, or is there more to it than that? Well, this has a lot of different names, but for today, we'll call it communion. And communion is something that the church has done for thousands of years. But what exactly is communion? Why do we do it? To answer that, we should look all the way back at the very first communion. Before Jesus went to the cross, he had one last meal with his disciples. While they were all there, Jesus took a cup and told his disciples to divide it among themselves. Then he broke up some bread into smaller pieces and gave a piece to each of his disciples. When Jesus had them all take and eat the bread, he said, "This is my body." The bread represented his body that would be broken. When they all took the cup, Jesus told them, "This is my blood." The cup represented his blood that was going to be poured out as a sacrifice for them on the cross. When they ate the bread and drank the cup, he told his disciples, "Do this in remembrance of me." This is why we take communion, to remember Jesus and what he did for us. The bread and the cup are physical symbols that Jesus gave us to remind ourselves of something much bigger that he did for us. So let's talk about the bread for a second. This isn't the first time that Jesus compared himself to bread. In John 6:48, he said, "I am the bread of life." What he meant by that was, just like our physical bodies need food to stay alive, our spirits need food too. Otherwise, they'll starve. When we eat the bread, we should remember that just like physical food sustains our physical lives, Jesus sustains us spiritually. Without Jesus, our spiritual bread, we would starve. Also, just like the bread that he broke and handed to his disciples, his body was about to be broken. Because Jesus' body was broken, they could be made whole. The same is true for us. When we eat the bread, we should remember that Jesus' body was broken the day he went to the cross. Because of that, we can have healing. Not just physical healing, but emotional healing and spiritual healing as well. Jesus was broken, just like the bread, so that we could be made whole. Now, let's talk about that cup. Back before Jesus came to earth, when people sinned, the only way to be right with God was to sacrifice an animal that had no imperfections. That may sound kind of weird, but that's how seriously God views sin. The Bible says that the cost of sin is death. So every time they sinned, they had to sacrifice another animal, and even still, they weren't changed on the inside. But all of those sacrifices, with their emphasis on blood, were a picture of the real sacrifice that would be coming and would change people from the inside. The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus was that perfect sacrifice. When we drink the cup, we should remember that it is only because of Jesus' blood that we are able to be born again into God's family. Without Jesus' sacrifice, we would be doomed to be separated from God forever because of our sin. So the bread and the cup are just a physical way to remind us of the amazing thing that Jesus did for us. First and foremost, communion is a time to remember. Remember what Jesus did for you. Remember that only He can sustain you spiritually, and that His body was broken so that you could be made whole. Also, remember that His blood was spilled to pay the price for your sins, so that you could be a part of God's family. Communion is also a time to examine ourselves. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11:28 that we should examine ourselves before we take communion. Communion's a serious deal. We need to take it with the right attitude. This is a good time to ask yourself questions like, is there something that I need to ask forgiveness for? If so, now's the time to do that. Or maybe ask yourself, am I living a life that brings honor to the broken body and the blood that Jesus spilled for me? If not, take the time to ask forgiveness and commit to living a life that brings honor to Jesus before taking communion. Communion is a great time to examine ourselves. Lastly, communion is a time for community. A lot of times when we take communion, we use pre-prepared, already broken up pieces of bread rather than using one singular loaf of bread that we split up. So it's easy to forget the significance of the picture that we are all a part of one body, the body of Christ. Because Christ's body was broken, we can all be united in that one body, no matter who we are. Young or old, big or small, rich or poor, if we've made Jesus our Lord, we are bound together as one body. It's the broken body and the blood of Jesus that binds us together as a family. So communion is a time to remember what Jesus did for us. It's a time to examine ourselves on whether we're living a life that honors Jesus or not. And it's a time for community. Remember that no matter what background you come from, when we're a part of God's family, we are all brothers and sisters in Christ.
That was a great lesson for this week. I can't wait for next week and see what happens. Pastor Ethan, you did an amazing job. You really did. Thank you guys for being here with us. Come visit us. 8:30, 10:30. We are open. We're safe. We're sanitized. We're clean. We're wearing masks. We're social distancing. This is a safe environment. So please come back and visit us here at Kid City. We really miss you. But we will put next week's lesson online. So get ready. It's going to be great.